Why, hello there. My name's Thaddeus, and I'm really excited about suffering. You're probably thinking, who is this crazy guy? He says he's excited about suffering. Is he some kind of masochist? Well, all right, I'm not really excited about suffering, but I am excited about the opportunity to talk to you about suffering. And the reason why is because Christianity has some really good explanations for why we suffer. But before getting into the heart of my video, a couple introductory remarks. First of all, this is my first ever YouTube video, so leave your constructive criticism down below in the comments. Be a big help. Second of all, I know this is going to be a fairly long video, but I think if you watch through the whole thing, you'll get a lot out of it. With that out of the way, I'd like to take a look at a couple quotes as a way to introduce the topic. The first quote is attributed to the classic philosopher Epicurus. Writing about 300 BC, he says, "If God is willing to take away evil and is unable to do so, he is feeble. If he is able and unwilling, he is malevolent. If he is both willing and able, which alone is suitable for God, from what source then are evils? Or why does he not remove them?" Nothing like this exact quote is found in the writings of Epicurus. But that's not surprising, because most of his writings haven't survived to the present day. However, from what we know about his writings, we can safely conclude that Epicurus was not, in fact, arguing for atheism. Instead, he was arguing against the idea of providence, that is, that God is in control of all things, and is working always for our good. The next couple quotes I pulled randomly off the modern home of philosophy, Twitter. The first is from a young lady who calls herself .nerd. She writes mostly about atheism. When asked why she believes in atheism, she responded, "I am an atheist for the issues I have seen. I don't see a good God stopping poverty or suffering. There is no reason to believe that a perfect God would not create a perfect world." The second quote comes from JR. JR mostly writes about anime, but one day, he decided to take some time out of his usual activities and muse as follows. "Why did God put that evil tree in the Garden of Eden? Why did he even create it anyway? If God can see the future, it means he knew Adam and Eve would eat the fruit and bring suffering in the world, but he still put it there. He already knew they would disobey him, yet he still cursed them. Why?" So we have a classic philosopher who sees some incompatibility between the idea of a good God and the existence of evil, an atheist who gives the existence of evil as her primary argument against God, and a regular guy who normally doesn't talk about religion, but took some time out of his day to wonder aloud why evil exists. Unlike most problems philosophers muse about, this, known as the problem of evil, is something that affects us all. We all suffer, and we all don't want to suffer, and thus we all must give an explanation for why we see evil. Before getting into the heart of the discussion, I want to make it clear that there's really two problems of evil. The first is the intellectual problem, how a good God and evil are compatible. The second is the personal problem, how to actually deal with suffering when you encounter it. This talk will primarily focus on the first problem. However, I will have a few things to say towards the end about how Christianity deals with suffering in the actual world. The first part of my presentation will look at the different options that are available to explain the existence of evil. The second part will look at what philosophers call a defense, that is, an explanation on how Christianity and evil are compatible. I'll then go a step further and offer what philosophers call a theodicy, that is, an explanation of the evil we see in the world. And then lastly, I'll take a look at what the proper Christian response is to the evil and suffering that we find in the world. The first key point I want to make is that evil is something everyone must deal with. People sometimes act like this is a problem only for Christianity, that if we reject the Christian conception of God, that'll somehow solve the problem. This is completely untrue. As I have already pointed out, everyone suffers, and everyone feels that there's an intrinsic evil in the world, thus everyone is responsible for providing an explanation. Simply rejecting the Christian worldview does nothing to solve the problem. We all must provide some sort of explanation for evil. Where did it come from? Why does it persist? Or is it even real to begin with? As it turns out, there's only a few different ways to answer these problems. As a way of introducing the various different ways, I'll take a look at a number of worldviews. Now, obviously, with a two-minute presentation, I can't give a complete Hindu view or a complete Buddhist view. So instead, just think of these as ways to introduce the topic, not definitive explanations of how different people view the problem. First up, I'll take a look at classic polytheism. I figure this is a safe place to start because there aren't too many people around today who worship Zeus or Hera. So it's not too likely to offend anyone by looking at Greek polytheism. In the Greek idea, and in most polytheistic systems in general, the gods are not exactly good or bad, per se. Rather, they have complex moral character, similar to humans. Thus, if a community or individual is suffering, it's probably because you did something to offend the gods. Now, on an intellectual level, this actually solves the problem quite nicely. If the gods are not good, then it's not hard to explain why we see evil in the world. However, on a practical level, it has substantial problems. First of all, the individual who is suffering is generally blamed for their own suffering. And second of all, there's little anyone can do to alleviate suffering. At best, you can offer a sacrifice and hope it works. And thus, there's little incentive for humans to work towards the end of suffering. Next up is Hinduism. With all the views we're looking at today, there's a diversity of thought, but this is especially true in Hinduism. So instead of thinking of this as the Hindu view, just think of it as one Hindu view. In one line of Hindu thought, karma is the primary cause of suffering in the world. Karma, simply put, is the law of cause and effect. If you do bad things to other people, bad things happen to you. If you do good things to other people, good things generally will happen to you. Now, of course, in the real world, we don't see that doing good always leads to good things happening to you, and likewise, people who do evil are not always punished within this lifetime. Hinduism solves this problem through the doctrine of rebirth. If you end your life with a positive karma balance, you can expect to be reborn in a more favorable circumstance. Likewise, if you end your life with a negative karma balance, you can expect to be reborn in a less favorable circumstance. On the surface, this appears to be a reasonable explanation for suffering. You suffer because you do bad things. Everyone would like to believe that's true. Unfortunately, that's generally not what we see in the world. And inventing the idea of rebirth doesn't really help the situation. Is it really fair for a baby to suffer immensely for something it did in its previous life? Is it really fair for anyone to suffer for something they have no conscious memory of? And on a practical level, it's a complete failure. If you teach that people are suffering because of their own actions, either during this lifetime or in a previous lifetime, then of course there's little incentive to work to alleviate their suffering. After all, it's their own fault. Taken to the extreme, this idea led to the creation of the caste system. Seeing these problems with Hinduism, Siddhartha Gautama, now known as the Buddha, rejected Hinduism and sought to find a better way. Ultimately, his ideas led to what we now know as Buddhism. In Buddhism, the Four Noble Truths, the core of Buddhist thought, are all about suffering. In short, pain and suffering is caused by our attachment to false ideas. We desire a state of permanent satisfaction, but the world is always changing. We seek out things to satisfy our desires, but things cannot fulfill our desires because they too are only temporary. When our efforts fail to find fulfillment seeking after worldly things, we grow angry and suffer. Suffering is thus alleviated when we realize the true state of the universe and adjust our cravings. Practically, this is done primarily through meditation and self-discipline. Practically speaking, Buddhism has a lot to offer. The Eightfold Path to End Suffering teaches many good lessons. It teaches you to respect other people's property and their lives. It teaches you self-discipline. and it promotes truth. Changing one's attitudes can indeed go a long way towards alleviating suffering. However, where Buddhism fails is on the intellectual level. Buddha's ideas about why we suffer were tied to his understanding of reality. He believed that everything causes everything else, and that the universe has no beginning and no end. Furthermore, he taught that there is no such thing as the individual, that everyone is just part of one whole. Some schools of Buddhism even go so far as to deny the existence of a physical universe entirely. Unfortunately, these teachings contradict our observations. The universe does seem to have a beginning, and we do seem to be individual beings. It's hard to see how we could know anything about anything if we deny the existence of self. And at a philosophical level, the noble truths depend on this understanding of the universe, and thus fail. Next up is Islam. As a monotheistic faith, it has many of the same options to deal with suffering as Christianity does, so I won't spend a great deal of time talking about Islam. In the Quran, the primary way that suffering is explained is via a divine test. By enduring the test and calling upon Allah for help, the believer can achieve earthly blessing. For example, in the brief retelling of the story of Job, the Quran says that Job called out to Allah, and Allah told him to strike the ground with his foot. A spring of water then burst forth, and his family and possessions were returned to Job due to his faith. Certainly, the idea of a divine test does occur occasionally in the Bible. However, it's not a major theme, and I don't think it's a major explanation for why we suffer. Classical Muslim theologians, debating the existence of free will, came to much the same conclusion. The most common suggestion within classical Muslim thought is that any apparent evil is actually a good, because it serves Allah's purpose in some way. Later Muslim theologians have developed other ideas. Last up, I'll take a look at atheism. Should point out that just as in all these systems we've looked at, there's a diversity of thought within atheism as well. Certainly, one can reject the idea of the existence of God and not replace it with anything in particular. However, those who think deeply about their atheism usually come to the conclusion that naturalism is true. Naturalism is basically the idea that everything that exists is governed solely by natural laws, that there is nothing other than physical matter and natural laws. As such, my comments will be about naturalism and not necessarily a generic atheism. Secondly, I should point out that my comments are about the worldview of naturalism, not about individual atheists. I will shortly argue that naturalism doesn't have an intellectual basis for sustaining the idea of evil. However, when I do this, I'm not saying that individual atheists are immoral people or don't believe in evil or anything like that. Just as I wasn't talking about individual Buddhists when I talked about Buddhism, I'm not talking about individual atheists when I talk about the worldview of naturalism. And indeed, most atheists live what would generally be considered a good moral life. With that out of the way, let me take a look at what naturalism has to say about the problem of evil. Most atheists will act like the problem of evil is not something they need to explain, that it's only a problem for other worldviews. And indeed, as we saw in the introduction, many atheists will go so far as to argue that the existence of evil is the primary reason to believe in atheism. First of all, even if evil was a good argument against Christianity, and I certainly hope to show that it's not, it certainly wouldn't be an argument against a generic God. For example, the God or gods that exist may not be morally good. Additionally, some worldviews don't really believe in the existence of gods per se, but only spiritual laws that govern the organization of the universe. Second, naturalism has a difficult time defining what evil is within its own framework. The classical approach is to admit that absolute good and absolute evil don't exist. Rather, there's only things that we like and things that we don't like. A society decides what's moral and what's not moral within that society. Certainly, we can create laws that enforce moral principles such as do not steal or do not murder someone, and these laws will generally benefit society. However, we can't really say that the individual who is able to violate these laws and get away with it is doing something morally wrong. If someone is able to violate society's moral laws, either through their own cunning or the power they've achieved or some other way, there's nothing really to argue that they shouldn't do this. Indeed, one could argue that these people have superior genes and should take advantage of other people in order to advance themselves. If they're more well off, they'll be more likely to propagate their so-called superior genes. For most people, it is perfectly rational to follow society's moral principles. However, for the privileged few that can violate these laws, there doesn't really seem to be any reason why they shouldn't. Rationally, they should probably seek to advance their own well-being rather than play by the rules. Alternatively, naturalists can simply assert that moral laws are a lot like natural laws, that they've always existed, and that there's no need to explain them. On a popular level, this view has become a lot more common in recent years. However, on an intellectual level, it's a complete failure. First of all, moral laws are quite unlike natural laws. I can't just decide that I'm going to go out and violate the law of gravity, but I can just go out and decide I'm going to violate the law against stealing. So certainly, they don't look like they're the same thing. Additionally, under naturalism, we can assume that all creatures got here by random evolutionary processes. However, the evolutionary history does not support the idea that creatures have become more moral over time. Indeed, if we look at the higher creatures, they're more likely to be violent than lower creatures. Furthermore, many moral laws only plausibly apply to humans. For example, all other animals lack the ability to lie because they lack the ability to make speech. And the moral laws that could apply to animals seem to be regularly violated. For example, many animals eat their own young, and no one acts like a tiger is evil when it kills prey to eat. Is the suggestion that there are moral laws that have existed since the beginning of time, but only apply to one creature on one planet in the entire universe, as far as we know, any more plausible than the idea of the Christian God? I don't see how it possibly could be. Thus far, we've seen that there's just a few options for explaining why evil exists. Might be a result of external forces that are beyond our control. Might be the result of our own actions, and thus something we can directly or indirectly control. Or perhaps evil is just a word we use to describe our pain and is not actually a real thing. Or maybe all apparent evil is actually good because it leads to greater good. Before looking at an explicitly Christian explanation for evil, I'd like to lay out a philosophical defense. That is, I'd like to show that the existence of a good God and the existence of evil are compatible. The classical problem of evil is stated in the form of three propositions. Number one, God is all-powerful. Number two, God is completely good. And number three, evil exists. The claim is that there's some sort of logical contradiction between these three ideas. And since the third one, that evil exists, is said to be obviously true, then one of the first two propositions must be false. Now, there are several problems with this claim. First of all, we haven't actually defined what evil is, and we haven't shown it to actually exist. We've just kind of assumed that we know what evil is, and we assume that it exists. We could simply define evil as whatever violates God's will, and say that God wills human suffering. Logically, this solves the problem. However, we normally believe that what we perceive as evil is actually evil. So let's adopt a working definition of evil as anything that causes human suffering. There are two broad types of evil, then. What we call moral evil and natural evil. Moral evil is any suffering that is caused by a moral agent, that is, beings that understand that there's a difference between good and evil and have the ability to choose between good and evil. Examples of moral evil would be things like rape, murder, stealing, and so on. Natural evils are things that do not appear to be caused by moral agents. Prime example of natural evil would be something like a natural disaster or a disease. In this video, I'll focus primarily on moral evils, as these are the ones that tend to bother people the most, although I will have a few words to say about natural evil as well. As I previously explained, I don't think that naturalism can really sustain this definition of evil. However, for purposes of argument, it'll just be taken as a given. Even so, where is the problem? Certainly, there is no implicit contradiction in the set of propositions, as an implicit contradiction would be something like evil cannot exist and evil does exist. If there's an implicit contradiction between these three propositions, then it should not be difficult to draw it out. The most famous attempt to do so was perhaps made by J.L. Mackey. Mackey adds the following propositions to the set. Number 4, a good thing always eliminates evil as far as possible. And number 5, there are no limits to what an all-powerful being can do. For Mackey's argument to work, both of these propositions must be what philosophers call necessarily true. That is, the proposition must be true in all possible worlds, that is, all worlds that can be imagined, not just observed in the actual world in which we live. To defeat number 4, the theologian only needs to show that it is possible that there are morally sufficient reasons for God to allow evil to exist. Which leads us to our first defense, which is ignorance of God's motives. Now I realize this is not a particularly satisfying explanation for the non-Christian or even for the Christian. However, it is intellectually sound, and I do present it for a reason, even though I feel we can do better. In the biblical book of Job, Job is described as a very righteous person. The reader is informed that Satan is torturing Job in order to try to prove to God that Job is only righteous because of the good gifts he receives from God. As the story progresses, Job is visited by a couple friends. These friends suggest that Job must have done something wrong, otherwise he wouldn't be suffering. If you just think harder, Job, you'll figure out what you did, and then you can confess your sin and end your suffering. Towards the end of the book, God himself enters the scene and speaks to Job as follows. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man. I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. It is clear that God is making Job aware of how insignificant his understanding is in comparison to the knowledge of God. He never does go on to tell Job exactly why he was suffering, but he does rebuke Job's so-called friends who claimed that Job was suffering due to some sin. Thus, we see that God's only defense of himself, within the story of Job at least, is that he's God and we're not, so we shouldn't expect to be able to know his motives. He does, however, rule out sin as the sole source of suffering. As I already stated, pleading ignorance is not a particularly satisfying defense. However, intellectually, it does have a lot to offer. If we have good, independent reasons to believe God exists, and I certainly believe we do, then we really shouldn't expect to know his motives. After all, God is infinite and all-knowing, and we aren't. Thus, it would be downright unreasonable for us to expect to always know the reason why things happen, including suffering. A more appealing answer to the problem of evil is to assert that all apparent evils always lead to greater good. In the biblical story of Joseph, Joseph has a prophetic dream that angers his family. In order to take revenge on him, his brothers sell him into slavery. Joseph finds some favor with his new slave master as he serves him well. However, the slave master's wife plots against Joseph and ends up getting him thrown in prison. Joseph's suffering has thus increased further. He was betrayed by his own family and now finds himself in jail through no fault of his own. How could this possibly be a good thing? While in prison, Joseph eventually attracts the attention of the Egyptian pharaoh. Joseph earns the pharaoh's trust by correctly interpreting his dreams. After predicting a famine, Joseph is put in charge of food distribution for all of Egypt. After a little while, his family comes seeking food. When Joseph eventually makes himself known to his brothers, they are afraid because they figure that he will want to get revenge on them. However, the brothers ask for forgiveness, to which Joseph replies, "Do not fear, for I am in the place of God. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." Joseph suffered betrayal at the hands of his own brothers, spent years in slavery, and found himself in prison. Yet he is able to see it through and see a greater good come about from his suffering. If Joseph had never been betrayed, then many people would have ended up dying of famine, possibly including his own family. Of course, in the real world, we don't always see that our suffering leads to greater good. And some evils, such as murder, cannot possibly lead to greater good for the victim of the evil. Thus, a generic greater good defense is really a variation on the ignorance defense. Even so, we can see evidence that greater good comes about from evil, at least some of the time. For example, at least some characteristics which we consider to be good cannot exist in the absence of evil. Courage, for example, seems to be meaningless without some possibility of failure and/or suffering on the part of the person exhibiting the courage. Surely we cannot practice forgiveness if people are not first capable of doing us harm. And can we really be altruistic in the absence of the possibility of personal harm? And what would be the point of working for the benefit of others if they already have all they need? Even love is weakened in the absence of evil, as the primary way we express our love for someone else is to put their own needs ahead of ours. If we did not suffer any personal loss from such behavior, then our sacrifice would be meaningless. Which brings me to my second key point. At least some things which we consider to be very good require the existence of evil to be meaningful. When we describe someone as a good person, we probably mean that they exhibit traits such as putting the needs of others ahead of their own needs. However, this kind of good cannot exist in the absence of at least some suffering in the world. Indeed, if we say someone is doing good, we probably mean that they're working to alleviate suffering in the world. But in the absence of evil, there would be no suffering to eliminate. Thus, we can see that number four, a good thing always eliminates evil as far as is possible, is probably false. Remember, to defeat the logical problem of evil, we only need to show that number four or number five is false in any possible world. As it turns out, number five is false as well. Nearly every person who has ever pondered the idea of omnipotence has come to the conclusion that some things, such as logical contradictions, are not possible for even an all-powerful being. I will return to this idea shortly when I talk about free will. For these reasons, nearly all philosophers agree that the logical problem of evil has failed. That is, that there is no inherent contradiction between the idea of theism and the evil we exist in the world. However, this only proves that it's possible for God and evil to exist at the same time. The non-Christian can still argue that it's unlikely that God would exist given the world which we observe. This is what philosophers call the evidential or probabilistic argument of evil. Such an argument might go something like this. We observe many great evils in the world. We cannot think of any overriding good reasons for some of these evils to exist. But an all-powerful, all-good being would eliminate all evil that does not lead to greater good. Therefore, it is unlikely that such a being exists, based on our observations of the world. I think that this version of the argument is a lot more powerful, as it is probably where most people would end up if they really thought about the problem carefully. I don't think many people are bothered by the mere existence of evil, but instead are bothered by the amount of evil they see in the world. That is, someone might say, "I don't believe in God because I see too much evil in the world." That said, ultimately, it's a highly subjective case. There doesn't seem to be any objective way to define what too much evil is, so it's left to the individual person to decide. For some, a great evil such as the Holocaust is too much evil to explain, while others might be more bothered by a single, more personal evil, such as the death of their own child. Nor does the number of unexplained evils have a significant impact on the validity of the argument. For if there's an explanation to one unexplained evil, that same explanation probably applies to a number or even all unexplained evils. Still, the argument is powerful, even if it's difficult to precisely define, and thus the Christian must give a good response to the argument. Thus, I will seek to show that there are good explanations for the amount of evil we see in the world, given the truth of the Christian worldview. First, though, I think it's worth pointing out that the world in which we live is mostly good. This is not a point that philosophers usually make in these types of discussions, and certainly it's not a point that's necessary to show that God and evil are compatible. Even so, I think it's a valuable observation to make. After God created the world, in the book of Genesis, he reflected on his creation and concluded, "It was very good." Although man has since messed up the world in a number of ways, we can see that it's still primarily good through several different observations. First, when we look at the natural world, we intuitively believe that it's beautiful. We may see something such as a thunderstorm or a fungus as ugly, but for the most part, when we look at the natural world, we find it to be very beautiful. Second, we can see that the world is mostly good by how we perceive the problem of evil. We don't usually ask, why do good things happen to bad people, but rather, why do bad things happen to good people? In other words, we tend to expect good things to happen, and we mark bad things as things that need explanation. If the world was actually mostly evil, we would be surprised by the good things that happen rather than the bad things. Third, people almost always view staying alive as better than dying. If naturalism was true, then by definition, death would be neutral. Thus, a person acting rationally, who was experiencing more evil than good in their lives, should view death as a positive thing. Yet, almost no one ever does. One could argue that this is a rational judgment derived from evolutionary pressure to stay alive, but I don't find that explanation to be particularly satisfying, as the will to live goes on long after it's impossible for one to pass on their genetic information. Fourth, and most powerfully, we view having children as a good thing. When we have a child, we know that almost certainly that child is going to suffer, perhaps greatly, during their lifetime. Yet we choose to have children despite it being a significant sacrifice to our own well-being. We subject ourselves to physical and emotional pain to raise a child who herself will suffer physical and emotional pain. Yet we don't consider ourselves bad people for doing this. Indeed, we tend to view people who choose not to have children as the selfish ones, and the people who choose to have children as doing the great good. I believe that these behaviors are rational because I believe that our intuition is correct, that the world is mostly good. I will now turn to what philosophers call a theodicy. That is, an explanation for why evil exists, not just how it's compatible with the existence of God. Let me suggest that the existence of free will is one such explanation. God certainly could create a world without any evil. For example, he could create a world without any creatures whatsoever. Or, he could create a world that does have some creatures, but which have no free will, that they are just biologically programmed to do what is right. But would such creatures actually be morally good? I've already suggested that some moral goods require the existence of evil to be meaningful. Now, let me go a step further and suggest that morality requires the existence of free will. If a being is physically unable to do evil, then does it deserve any credit for the good it does? Likewise, if a creature is physically unable to avoid doing what we consider evil, does it really deserve to be blamed for the evil it does? I don't see how. Thus, it seems that if God wants to create a world where beings are capable of moral good, he must also create a world in which beings are capable of moral evil. It seems highly likely that a world with moral good is superior to a world without moral good, and thus God has a very good reason for creating a world where moral evil is possible. The most common response here is something along the lines of, "Yes, that sounds reasonable, but couldn't God create a world in which all creatures freely choose to always do good?" This sounds like a reasonable suggestion, but is it something that God could actually do? It turns out that it's not. To prove that, I'm going to use some technical language, but I do think it's worth the effort to understand. First, though, I'll offer a less formal demonstration of how even an all-powerful God cannot create a world in which no creatures freely choose to do moral evil. It is easy to see that our own actions are influenced by the free choices of other people. Certainly, we don't believe that our actions are entirely determined by other people, but they are influenced by other people to some degree. If there was only one person in the world, it would presumably be possible for God to structure the physical world so that this person never encountered a situation in which they wanted to do evil. However, once we put other people into the equations, it becomes more and more difficult for God to structure the world such that the interactions of the people never lead to some of them choosing to do evil. Intuitively, it seems like once you reach a certain number of free creatures, it is no longer possible for all of them to freely choose to do good all the time. More formally, we'll have to look at what philosophers call possible worlds. A possible world is basically a set of propositions which do not involve any logical contradictions. The actual world is, of course, the world in which we live. Now imagine a person in the actual world, a politician that we'll call Bob. Bob is offered a bribe to do some minor moral evil, which he chooses to accept. Now let's look at possible worlds. There clearly is one possible world that exactly matches the actual world. There is also another possible world which has all the same logical propositions, except the proposition that Bob accepts the bribe is replaced by the proposition that Bob rejects the bribe. However, both these worlds have the proposition that Bob is free to accept or reject the bribe. Since we already know how Bob will react when given the opportunity to accept this bribe, and he is free to choose to accept it or not accept it, it seems that the world in which all the propositions remain constant, except that Bob accepts the bribe is replaced by Bob rejects the bribe, is not a world that is possible for God to actualize. Now, we might imagine that God could solve this problem either by removing Bob or the briber from the equation. However, in the actual world, we find that everyone freely chooses to do evil at least some of the time. Thus, all humans suffer from what Alvin Plantinga calls trans-world depravity. We all choose to do evil as part of our essence, and thus there are no actualizable worlds in which we always freely do good. This is precisely what the Bible teaches as well. The Apostle Paul writes, "All, both Greek and Jews, are under sin. As it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God." What about natural evil, you may ask? How can suffering from a natural disaster or a disease be the result of free will? First, we shouldn't underestimate the amount of suffering from even a natural disaster that is the result of human sin. When a tornado strikes the United States, perhaps 100 people will die. When the same tornado strikes Bangladesh, several thousand will die. The difference is the amount of wealth these nations enjoy. In other words, global inequality has caused great suffering. Even in the United States, disasters disproportionately affect the poor. So it seems that some of the suffering from natural disasters is the result of human greed. Second, the Bible clearly teaches that there are free creatures much more powerful than ourselves. While the existence of angels and demons is no longer popular, there's certainly nothing logically difficult about it. Other explanations of natural evil do exist, but I won't go into this today, solely for time. Thus, I conclude that the free will defense, or theodicy, is logically sound. The problem of evil cannot be a strong argument against Christianity, at least on a logical basis. We don't need any further explanation for evil. However, it turns out the Bible has a lot more to say about this topic. Everything I've said thus far is compatible both with the world we observe and the teachings of Christianity. The Bible, however, goes further and provides us a more comforting explanation for suffering, which is classically known as the soul-making theodicy. Let me start here with a word of caution. Perhaps you've heard a so-called Christian preacher say something along the lines of, "Accept Jesus, live a moral life, and everything will go great. You'll never have to suffer again." It is categorically false that the Christian should not expect to suffer. Indeed, if anything, the Bible promises the exact opposite, that Christians should expect much suffering in their lives. Anyone teaching that living a moral life automatically leads to earthly blessings is a false teacher, and they do not represent what the Bible teaches. Back in the 2nd century AD, Irenaeus argued that as created creatures, we are by nature imperfect. Just as we are immature physically at birth, we are also immature spiritually. When we trip and fall, it causes physical pain, which aids in our process of learning how to walk. Likewise, when we suffer emotional pain, it helps us develop spiritually. We don't suffer because God is punishing us per se, but rather we suffer as the natural consequence of human actions. Indeed, God allowing this sort of discipline is a sign of love, as the book of Hebrews remarks, "For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives." Does this mean that all suffering is the result of one's own sins? Certainly not. Instead, what the soul-making theodicy is arguing is that when we suffer, whether the result of our own actions or the result of someone else's actions, we gain benefit. James, the brother of Jesus, writes, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of the faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." The Apostle Paul writes, "We rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope." The theme of these verses is clear. When you suffer, try to realize that the suffering will cause you to grow as a person, and thus you receive benefit from your suffering. But is the character growth we receive really worth the cost of suffering? When we consider that the benefit is eternal, while the suffering is by nature limited in time, the answer is clearly yes. Paul, who suffered tremendously during his lifetime, makes this point well. "I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us." As Christians, we can take comfort in knowing that our God chose to take on human form and participate in our suffering. The Epistle of Hebrews says, "In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him." If Jesus, as God incarnate, needed to suffer to learn obedience, then of course we also must suffer during our lifetimes, or else we will be left immature for all of eternity. Thus, we have two strong explanations, free will and soul-making, for the suffering that we endure, and these have been the main two explanations that Christians have offered over the last 2,000 years. But let me offer a third, which comes primarily from my own reflection. In the Gospel of John, Jesus comes across a man who was born blind. His disciples ask him, "Who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" reflecting the common ideas of the day. Jesus denies that the blindness is a punishment, saying, "It was not that this man sinned, or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him." This man had suffered greatly throughout his life. As a blind person, he had no opportunity for employment and was reduced to begging to survive. No doubt, insults were hurled his way daily. Yet Jesus suggests that his suffering was not punishment, nor was it pointless, but rather his suffering played into God's purposes. I would like to suggest that this is true today as well, that the primary reason God allows suffering in the world today is to give opportunities for him to be glorified. We, as Christians, are called to demonstrate God's love in the world. One of the main ways we can do this is by helping those who are suffering. When we see someone who is suffering, we should do everything we can to help them, including simply giving a sympathetic ear for them to talk to. Seeing God's love reflected in us, they too will be attracted to God. As Jesus said, "By this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." But it's not just the suffering of others that gives us an opportunity to glorify God, but also our own suffering. The Apostle Paul writes, "We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. Paul suggests that all our sufferings, physical, mental, and emotional, allow us to participate in the death of Jesus, thus killing our sinful nature and replacing it with a godly nature. How we handle our pain shows the world the glory of God in our lives. This was not just a theoretical point for Paul, but one he actually lived. Paul writes how he prayed 3 times to have a thorn in his side removed. He got a reply, but it was not what he expected. God said, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness." God is not interested in using what the world considers great, the strong, the powerful, the wealthy, and so on, but rather what the world considers weak. That way it is clear where the true source of power lies, in God Himself, not in the person. In other words, it is through suffering that the power of God is manifested. I'd now like to bring the various defenses and theodicies together, which brings me to my 4th key point. Which of these various ideas is correct? I would suggest all of them. Just as there are many different causes of suffering in the world, we should expect that there are multiple different explanations for why evil is allowed to exist. In regards to specific events that happen, we probably will rarely know the exact reason why they happen. However, we can note that various goods, such as courage, empathy, self-sacrifice, and so on, require the existence of evil to be meaningful. And thus, we can expect that some combination of these goods is in play in most situations where we observe evil. More generally, we can see that the existence of free will also requires the existence of evil. God could endow us with free will, or He could make us robots that always do what is good, but He couldn't make us both free and always do what is right. When we do suffer, whether from the free will actions of others or from our own choices, we can see that we achieve benefit from it. Suffering allows us to grow and mature as persons. If we never suffered, we would remain immature and miss out on great good. Furthermore, in the Christian worldview, this benefit lasts for all of eternity, making any suffering insignificant in comparison. Additionally, the existence of evil allows us to model the love that God has given us as we help others with their suffering. Our own pain allows us to participate in God's story as our sinful nature is replaced by the glory of God. Given all this, how is the Christian supposed to respond to evil and suffering? On a personal level, the Christian should expect to experience suffering in their life. God does not promise the Christian a carefree life. If anything, He promises the opposite. Realizing that there's good reasons for our suffering makes it easier to endure suffering when it does arise. When a Christian does encounter suffering, she can greatly reduce the amount of pain she's in by adjusting her perspective. Research has shown that the majority of our pain, both mental and physical, comes not from the pain itself, but rather from the mental anguish of knowing that we are in pain. Thus, adjusting our mental attitudes can significantly reduce our pain. We can remind ourselves that Jesus Himself suffered greatly during His life and in His death. He was rejected by the people He came to help, finding just a handful of loyal followers. And even they abandoned Him in His final hours, hiding in fear. He endured the physical torture of flogging and crucifixion. God doesn't just let us suffer, He joins in our suffering, walking in the same path in which we walk. Through all His suffering, Jesus learned obedience. And on the 3rd day after His death, He rose again to eternal life. Just as He is risen, we too have hope of eternal life. In the face of eternity, even the worst suffering becomes what Paul describes as a light, momentary affliction. Reminding ourselves of this fact can bring significant comfort. Finally, Christians should remind ourselves that our suffering is an opportunity to grow as persons. When we handle our struggles with a grace-filled attitude, it brings glory to God. Certainly, viewing our suffering as an opportunity to serve God makes the suffering a lot easier to endure. On a broader scale, Christians are called to fight evil in this world. We are not to sit idly by while others suffer at the hands of evil, but rather we are called to fight against evil. We are called to advance the well-being of others at all times, even at the cost of our own well-being. When someone we know encounters suffering, Christians are called to be God's love in their life. By demonstrating God's love through our actions, we witness for God and help people to come to know Him. Most of the time, this just means being there for a person suffering, giving them someone to talk to, sharing in their pain, so to speak, by practicing empathy. Of course, if you are in the position to directly reduce someone's suffering, do so. But mostly, I'm just talking about reducing the mental anguish of being alone and in pain, and that is something anyone can do. I'll now give a brief summary of this video. I know it's been a long video, and I thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and subscribe to this channel. In summary, everyone must give account for evil. It is often suggested that the existence of evil is only a problem for Christians, that other worldviews don't have this problem. That is simply untrue. Everyone struggles with explaining evil regardless of their worldview. Philosophers have been trying for millennia to demonstrate that an all-good, all-powerful God is incompatible with the evil in the world. All such attempts have failed. Christianity, in particular, has many good explanations for the evil we observe. We all know that there are many different causes of evil in this world, so we should expect that there is multiple different explanations for that evil. On the simplest level, we shouldn't expect to know the exact reason for any given evil. God is all-knowing, and we simply aren't. However, we can see that many of the highest goods require the existence of evil. Things such as courage, forgiveness, and self-sacrifice require the existence of evil in order to be meaningful. Additionally, we observe a world that is primarily good. Free will fully explains the existence of evil and can be seen as a great good. Indeed, without free will, the concept of moral good and moral evil becomes meaningless. Becoming a Christian does not eliminate one's suffering. The Bible repeatedly tells us to expect suffering in our lives. However, this suffering matures our souls and prepares us for eternal benefit, making even the worst suffering seem insignificant in comparison. Realizing that fact and adjusting our perspectives accordingly can reduce our suffering on earth as well. Lastly, Christians cannot be indifferent to the suffering in the world. We are called to be God's representatives on earth and must fight against evil in all its forms. When we see that someone is suffering, we are given the opportunity to model God's love in their lives. Thus, arguably, the most important reason that God allows people to suffer is to draw them to Himself, not just giving us a simple head knowledge of His existence, but drawing us into a deep, personal relationship with our loving Father. Thanks for watching.